First of all, many thanks to all the people involved in the organization of this conference. Thank you for the invitation. As time is short, I will start immediately. We start with the title, which is already a claim. False beliefs about social entities and their argumentative irrelevance for the intentionality debate in social ontology. So let's start with the presentation plan. Ontology of art, section one, ontology of art and social ontology, two histories in reverse order. Section two, questioning the relevance of intentionality in social ontology, the argument and its implicit assumption. Section three, the irrelevance of false intentional beliefs for the relevance of intentionality in social ontology. So I will start with three main claims. First of all, the history of social ontology in the analytic philosophy followed curiously a sort of reverse order when compared to ontology of art. Why I say curiously? Because in theory, ontology of art is an application of social ontology, so we should expect that it follows the same order, but it's not the case. While the first studies in ontology of art were focused on purely metaphysical issues, I refer here to Margolis, Goodwin, and Bolland as some of the classical authors of the first studies in analytic ontology of art. You should also quote Wolterstorff and many others. With no particular attention in this early moment, no particular attention cast on the corresponding human beliefs about them, in a second moment, particularly starting from Levinson's seminal essay, What a Musical Work Is, but then thereafter, Kivi, Carey, Davis, Thomason, many others again, the question of human beliefs started to gain centrality as in ontology of art, as it was assumed that they are relevant in determining the ontological features of artworks. In social ontology, conversely, the centrality of human beliefs in determining the ontological features of social entities can be considered a common assumption which characterizes its early history. This early assumption started only in a second moment, and particularly in this last decade, to be questioned. So, I will argue for this third claim in the first two sections. In the third section, on the contrary, I will argue for the statement implicit in the title, that is of the irrelevance of the false beliefs about social entities for the relevance of the intentionality in social ontology. So let's start with the early history of social ontology, the debate about intentions. Between the end of the 80s and the beginning of the 90s, social ontology, at least in the domain of analytic philosophy, experienced a flourishing of articles and books. I refer here to Gilbert, Trumel and Miller, Searle, Bratman, Petit, among the most well-known, devoted to the question of the so-called we intentions, that is, the kind of intentionality involved in collective actions. This debate started more than 30 years ago and is still alive. The fact that it's still alive, it's shown by the fact that in the last years, there's been a lot of studies devoted, for example, to the notion of collective intentionality of Searle, both criticizing it and defending. And I will refer to some of these studies also in these slides. So the three main positions adopted in the debate about we intention. Here, I don't have any ambition of being exhaustive. But I will refer to three paradigmatic positions by three main actors of this debate. First of all, we intention can and should be reduced to I intention. This is a particular position represented by Bratman and Tuomela. I quote Bratman, with respect to a group consisting of you and me and concerning joint activity J, we intend to J if and only if one. Also, one A, I intend that we J and one B, you intend that we J. Second, I intend that we J in accordance with and because of 1A, 1B, enmeshing subplans of 1A, 1B, and you intend likewise. Third, 1 and 2 are common knowledge between us. Second position, we intention cannot and should not be reduced to I intention. However, they are performed exclusively by individuals. You know, I quote particularly Gilbert and Searle. I will refer to Searle in this passage, to his most recent study on social ontology, book, monography. The fact that all intentionality has to exist in the heads of individuals does not require that intentionality be reducible to intentionality. There is no reason why we cannot have an irreducible intention in each of our heads when we are engaging in some cooperative activity. Of course, there are differences between Searle and Gilbert or between Bratman and Tuomela. Here I'm trying to give a sketch of three main positions in relation to this debate. The third position is that twin intentions are intentions performed by a group agent, or at least should be treated as such, intentional stance, in order to give satisfactory explanations of group agency. This position in particular represented by List and Petit. I quote this from also a quite recent monography. The shift in perspective opened up by the recognition of group agents is parallel to the one opened up when we move from thinking of an organism as a purely biological system to viewing it as an intentional agent that forms and acts on certain beliefs and desires. In short, it parallels the move from taking a physical stance towards a given system to taking an intentional stance. Here the reference is clearly to Dennett's seminal essay. So, the main reading that I intend to propose here is to identify a common assumption which is underlying all these three positions. So social entities as projections of individual and collective human beliefs as implicit common assumption explaining the centrality of intentionality in the early analytic social ontology. In spite of the differences, there is a common assumption in this debate about the nature of intentions. This assumption is that social intentionality, including social intentional beliefs, is relevant for explaining the functioning of the social world. According to Brian Epstein, this idea is paradigmatically also nowadays formulated by the so-called standard model of social ontology. He refers to an essay of Guala. This definition is from Guala. I quote Epstein, the idea of the standard model is this, the social world is a kind of projection of our thoughts or attitude onto the world. The bills in my pocket are money because we all think of them as money. The president has the powers he does because we grant him those powers. America is a nation because we think of it as such. The social world, quite generally, is the social world in virtue of our beliefs about it. So, this common assumption started to be increasingly questioned in these last two decades. The second assumption formulated by Epstein. This is the main subject of the next two sections. So in this section, I will proceed through four steps. In the first step, I will propose a typical formulation of this questioning. I refer here to Epstein. My aim in this paper is to argue that focusing on intentions and attitudes distorts our understanding of social ontology. In some sense, it is surely correct that social entities partially depend on people, society, and human intentionality. Otherwise, they would not be social at all. However, the role of intention and other attitudes is often overestimated, making prevailing views excessively intellectualist. Second step, providing a good reason for this questioning. In this case, I refer to Torrengo. The way even the most institutional and conventional aspects of social reality depend on human activity is no trivial matter. Institutional entities are neither flimsy, as individual thoughts and ways of behaving typically are, nor are they always easier to modify than physical ones. It may take very little effort to smash a stone into small pieces, but it does not seem to be within the power of any single individual to alter the value of a 5 euro note. End of quote. So, third step, let's see a supposed evidence for this question. It is legitimate, let's put it this way. I refer again to Epstein. Petri, Ilikowski, and Pekka Mekele, I hope to have pronounced that decently, have argued against collective acceptance accounts of institutions with examples that suggest that a wide range of beliefs about money, including non-collective beliefs and false beliefs, can surface for maintaining institution and practices of money. They argue, for instance, that the institution can be maintained if all members of a community believe that the monetary value of coins is a natural property of coins. This is a serious challenge to the collective acceptance theorist. So in the first critical step, I intend to sum up the whole argument in order to identify a common assumption of it. First, we have an explicitly endorsed inference. We have example of social entities, as we saw in the last slides, which can remain in place even in presence of exclusively false beliefs about their ontological features. The inference is that then, so intentionally, intentionality is not necessarily relevant for social ontology. An implicit endorsed assumption. The above formulated inference is only valid if we take it as the second and third sentence of a syllogism, whose first sentence, the first premise actually, is an implicitly endorsed assumption. The implicitly endorsed assumption is the following. If intentionality has to be relevant for social ontology, it is because of the relevance of the intentional contents of human beliefs for the coming into existence and the determination of ontological features of social entities. So, passing to the third and last section, the next section, we radically question the assumptions, so the first premise of this syllogism, and thereby claim the relevance of false beliefs for the debate about intentionality in social ontology. So it's exactly the question already formulated in the title. So in this last section, I will propose three different approaches for questioning the relevance of intentionality in social ontology. First, Robert Brandom, a spirit of trust, the distinction between force and content of the social norms. I quote from his recent commentary on Phenomenology of Spirit of Hegel. First quote, if we make the norms, institute them by our social practical attitudes, then how can they genuinely bind us? In what sense are we constrained by them? The worry is that if we get to decide, our practical attitudes determine not only that we are responsible, a matter of Freudian force or normative status, but what we are responsible for, the content of the responsibility, then it is hard to see how we have normatively bound ourselves at all. Second passage, again from Spirit of Trust, from his commentary on Hegel. We can think of this issue in terms of the distinction between norms, or normative statuses, and normative attitudes. This is the distinction between what we are actually responsible for or committed to, the content of those normative statuses, on the one hand, and what responsibilities or commitments we acknowledge or attribute, what we practically take or treat ourselves or others as responsible for or committed to, on the other. End of quote. Second approach. So questioning the implicit assumption about the relevance of intentionality in social ontology. So, Giuliano Torrenco, socially binding contents as different intentional contents. Facts, I quote, facts about the existence of CO tax crimes, corporation marriages, and the like are not grounded on the shared content of collective intentions. So this is the question. The nature of institutional entities depends, rather, on enactments that are collectively regarded as valid. I will use the term enactment to cover things such as laws, declarations, and contracts, whose contents are usually written in documents and are always external to the content of collective intention. This is clear. It sounds maybe a bit artificial, but this is what we do every day when we click on some disclaimer in the internet or when we sign a contract and we are not totally aware of all the contents. Partially of the work of lawyers is exactly grounded in this fact. Institutional contexts are characterized by the shared intention to regard the enactments that are produced according to established procedure as valid, namely, to defer to such enactments to establish the socially binding contents. So we defer. The contents are not automatically included in our beliefs. Third approach, Bernd Epstein, the distinction between grounds and anchors. First quote, Searle takes institutional effects such as F to hold in virtue of constitutive rules being in place in a context. In Searle's account, the first answer to the question in virtue of what is F the case is given within the constitutive rule for dollars. Searle says that this constitutive rule is bills one, bills issued by the Bureau of Engraving and Printing count as dollars in the United States. Second message from Epstein, this answer of course is incomplete unless we also explain in virtue of what the constitutive rule itself is in place. The answer given by Searle is that the constitutive rule one is in place in the United States in virtue of the fact of the form two. People in the US collectively accept rule one. So it is here clear that this second point is exactly the distinction between force and content. One thing is the content of rule. The other thing is how this rule is in place. It is enacted somehow. It has force. A useful way to look to the at the difference between one and two is this. The former has the job of giving the condition an object must satisfy in order to be a dollar, while the latter has the job of giving the facts that put those satisfaction conditions in place. The facts expressed by two are thus not the grounds for F itself, but what I will call F's anchors. This distinction is a crucial one. There are two very different roles for intentions and other factors in various accounts of social ontology. So this last is a very crucial point, as we will see in the provisional conclusions. First, the relevance of intentionality in social ontology should not be limited to the significance of shared intentional beliefs about social entities for their ontological features, grounding relevance. Such relevance can and should also be intended in terms of its significance for the enacting of determinate normative frames which determine the ontological feature of social entities, anchoring relevance. For this reason, the possibility of instituting and keeping in existence a particular social entity by anchoring a frame, specifying its grounding conditions, Epstein, in presence of excluably false beliefs about this, is no argument against the relevance of intentionality in social ontology. This does not exclude that, first, so such normative frames can, in some cases, be enacted also in absence of shared intentions. This is quite delicate question to be seen, but we remain open, neutral about that. And second, the content of shared beliefs can, of course, in some cases, be relevant for the ontological features of social entities. I thank you in advance for your attention.